amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Hey, brothers and sisters, welcome to the third weekend in Lent, and the gospel reading assigned for this Sunday, this weekend, is the moment in the Gospel of John with the woman at the well. And John records that moment for us in John chapter 4, beginning at verse 4, where John writes this. It says, "Now he," that's Jesus, "had to go through Samaria. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground where Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, 'Will you give me a drink?' His disciples had gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, 'You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans.' Jesus answered her, 'If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water.' 'Sir,' the woman said, 'you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock?' Jesus answered, 'Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life.' The woman said to him, 'Sir, give me this water, so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water.' He told her, 'Go, call your husband and come back.' 'I have no husband,' she replied. Jesus said to her, 'You are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, you've had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have said is quite true.' 'Sir,' the woman said, 'I can see that you are a prophet.' 'I am he.' Just then, his disciples returned and were surprised to find him talking with a woman. But no one asked, 'What do you want?' or 'Why are you talking with her?' Then, leaving her water jar, the woman went back to the town and said to the people, 'Come, see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Messiah?' So they came out of the town and made their way toward him. Meanwhile, his disciples urged him, 'Rabbi, eat something.' But he said to them, 'I have food to eat that you know nothing about.' Then his disciples said to each other, 'Could someone have brought him food?' 'My food,' said Jesus, 'is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Don't you have a saying, it's still 4 months until harvest? I tell you, open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe for the harvest. Even now, the one who reaps draws a wage and harvests a crop for eternal life, so that the sower and the reaper may be glad together. Thus the saying, one sows and another reaps, is true. I sent you to reap what you have not worked for. Others have done the hard work, and you have reaped the benefits of their labor.' Many of the Samaritans from the town believed in him because of the woman's testimony, 'He told me everything I ever did.' So when the Samaritans came to him, they urged him to stay with them, and he stayed 2 days. And because of his words, many became believers. They said to the woman, 'We no longer believe just because of what you said. We have now heard for ourselves, and we know that this man really is the Savior of the world.'" So that ends the reading. It's a beautiful moment, actually on the heels of the gospel reading from last week, Jesus and Nicodemus, where Jesus speaks, you know, sort of those well-known words in John 3:16-17, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life." And then in verse 17, "For the Son of Man has come into the world not to condemn the world, but to give life to the world." The gospel, in a nutshell, John 3:16-17, those verses have made their way onto bumper stickers and signs and jewelry. And we talked about that last week, just beautiful words of Jesus. And then kind of on the heels of that, we have this wonderful moment in John chapter 4 with Jesus, a Jewish man, and this woman at the well, a Samaritan woman. There's all kinds of sort of racial ethnic divides at this time. There's a whole backstory behind John's comment, "For Jews do not associate with Samaritans." We're not going to get into that. But sort of as we were reading through the text and thinking about the message today, began to think through kind of probably what's in the woman's mind, certainly what's in the mind of a lot of believers in the first century, the Old Testament church, and even today. You know, when people think about religion, when they think about religious things, there's often a progression of thought, and maybe this was your backstory, your faith story. When many people think of religion or religious things, they often think of a progression. So I got to believe first, then I got to behave, and then I belong to the family. Sort of believe first, that is sort of knowing and buying into all the things. Sort of I got to have it figured out in my head and my heart. I got to believe first, which for a lot of times it's a big hurdle for folks. The scriptures actually tell us on our own we can't do it. And so that really becomes a total work of the Spirit in our life. By faith, the Spirit of God does that in us. So believe first, convinced ourselves of that. Some of us did have. Behave second, that is doing all the family community actions. Sort of have to believe first, then I sort of learn what the rules are and how to behave, and then at that point, I can belong. Then it can become part of the family, the local church family, or the community of believers. And many of us kind of, that was our experience and our background. Religion teaches that progression. Believe first, behave second, and then finally belong. But notice here in John 4 and in John 3:16, as Jesus is speaking to Nicodemus, and often in the Gospels, Jesus does not advocate that progression of thought. He really turns that on its head and instead communicates this. Jesus teaches and models something different for us. He teaches and models belonging first, and he actually redefines behave entirely from a religious system, and then believe. Belong first. You belong to the people of God, to the family of God, to your local church family. Behave, redefined. We're going to talk about that in a minute. And then believing, progression of thought. I mean, what would kind of change in our hearts and our minds if first and foremost we just knew we were in? First and foremost, we already knew we belonged to God. We already knew we belonged to a church family, a local church family of believers, the body of Christ. That ends up shaping things a little bit differently. And so belonging first, the scriptures affirm this to us over and over. Before anything else, your family. Before anything else, before any activity of yours, before any good deeds of yours, before any understanding or conviction, part of the family. Paul writes these words in Romans 5. He says, "But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. Before we were family, while we were sinners, Christ died for us." You know, the Lord didn't wait till we had it all together to sort of set this thing in motion and reclaim us and redeem us and buy us back and come after us. His grace and his mercy following us all the days of our life, right? Pursuing us all the days of our life. Before anything else, your family. The scriptures tell us that. In another place, in 1 Peter chapter 2, Peter writes, "But you're a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness and into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, now you have received mercy." Now, Peter's kind of making this point that God has chosen us. He's called you. He has called me by name. We belonged before we behaved, before we believed. God called us by name. And then these words in John 3:16 and 17, we heard last week, and it's a reminder to us. God didn't love us after we figured it out. He loved us before. We belonged first. "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn, but to save the world through him." Those beautiful words in John 3. So belong first, the scriptures teach us. So if we belong first, part of the family, the body of Christ, the people of God, if belonging happens first, behavior then takes on a whole new tone. Jesus redefines religious behavior. And when people come to Jesus and they ask, well, what's it mean? What must I do? How does this thing work? Jesus, in a number of places, advocates pursuing the kingdom, pursuing righteousness. You know, the first and foremost, the Lord has pursued you, and you're not doing these good things to earn God's favor. You're not behaving to earn the favor of God. We actually are now locked into the kingdom of God so that the world benefits, because God has called us by name in Christ. And so Jesus sort of gives us an insight to what the family should be doing. So if we belong first, Jesus says in Matthew 6, but seek first the kingdom. Seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be given to you as well. But seek first the kingdom and the righteousness of Christ, and then all these things will be added unto you. Babe, this is what the family does, Jesus is saying. What does the family do? What does the family look like when it's working well, when it's quote-unquote behaving well? Well, John gives us these words in 1 John 4. He says, dear friends, and that's family language, dear friends, since God so loved us, now let us love one another, because that's what the family does. When the family's at its best, this is what the family is doing. John writes earlier in his first letter, dear children, again, that's family language, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth. This is how we know we belong to the truth and how we set our hearts at rest in his presence. This is how we know we belong. Christ has claimed us to be his own, and when we're loving one another, that is evidence. Those actions are evidence of our belonging. We don't do the good things so that we belong. We belonged first, and now that shapes what we do. And so then, because we belong, that shapes how we behave. We believe. Because I belong, and I've seen behave in action, now I believe. Now, John writes at the end of this gospel, sort of all his entire gospel, really in just kind of two verses, we could sum it up. He's giving us a summary statement here. He writes, Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book, but these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you might have life in his name. So powerful, so good, a reminder to us that we've belonged first. Jesus is shaping for us what our actions look like. And then we believe because of the work that he has done. It's not the other way around. And so religion says, believe, behave, and then you can belong. You know, Jesus models for us and teaches us, no, no, no. Belonging happens first. That shapes our actions, our behavior. And then we believe because of the work that he's done. And so as we're journeying through the season of Lent, kind of with this discipleship theme, Amazing Grace, celebrating the 250th anniversary of the authorship of that beautiful hymn, one of the most well-known hymns. Now, thinking about God's amazing grace that we belonged first, behavior is shaped by that, and then we believe as a result of what God has done in us. Maybe just three challenging questions for you to be wrestling with this week. It goes something like this. Which one of these best describes your faith journey? Sort of religious, believe, behave, belong, or as Jesus teaches us, belong, shapes behavior, and then ultimately that we believe on account of what Christ has done. You know, if you were to begin to think like Jesus, what would change for you? You know, if you were to sort of put aside that religious mindset, if that's you, if that describes you and your faith journey and where you're at, what would kind of change for you personally if you began to think about it the way Jesus talks about it? And then maybe a third challenging question here at St. John's in our local church or in your local church, in your church family, wherever that might be. If we as a church family more and more began to think like Jesus, what would change? What would change in ministry? What would change in the way we do business? What would change in the way we interact with each other as church family and with outsiders? And with those who don't know Jesus and those who don't think like us, what would change for you personally, corporately as the body of Christ, if more and more we might think maybe be thinking about it in terms of belonging first, shaping our behavior, and then ultimately that more and more would come to believe in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. So maybe wrestle with that this week. Beautiful moment in John chapter 4 where Jesus, he's doing this. It's an example. He's mentoring us and teaching us what it means to belong first. And so as we close out our time in God's Word, let me pray over you. Lord Jesus, you've called us each by name. We belonged first. And God, when we've bought into a religious system where we had to sort of have it all figured out before we could belong, and we had to believe it, sort of have all the information right and have all the answers right first, and then we had to follow all the rules and check all the boxes, and then we would belong to the people of God and belong to you. And God, your word teaches us something very different, flips that whole system on its head, and you know, we belonged first, and that shapes our actions, and then we believe because of what you've done in our lives. God, cause us to wrestle with that this week by the power of your Spirit. If we sort of have a background in Christianity with a religious mindset, God, grant us an extra measure of your grace and an extra measure of belonging, that we would know that with confidence, because everything changes once we begin there. We love you. Thanks for loving us. It's in the precious name of Jesus we pray. Amen. All right, brothers and sisters, you belong. And may your actions this week be a great blessing to someone else, that in time perhaps they believe. And so the Lord be with you. Go get them this week in the name of Christ. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now